Hey, welcome back inside our Proactive Newsroom, and joining me now from the OTC studios in New York City, joining us is Jason Paltrowitz, Executive Vice President of the OTC Markets. Jason, good to see you again.
Good to see you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, also is Richard Carleton, the CEO of the CSE. Richard, nice to see you as well.
Absolutely, Steve. Thank you.
And also is Sarah-Louise Porter from the Aquis Exchange. And Sarah-Louise, it's nice to meet you as well.
Thank you. Good to meet you too.
Yeah. So everyone is at the OTC today for a conference and sort of companies that cross-pollinate between a number of different exchanges. And Jason, maybe you can kind of talk to us a bit first about putting on this event and the importance of having other countries and other markets and other exchanges.
Yeah, Steve, again, thanks for having us. And we're really excited. I said earlier today, hopefully this is the inaugural Global Markets Forum with the Canadian Securities Exchange and Aquis. And for us, you know, we've spoken before, 92% of the dollar volume on our market is non-U.S. So we're really passionate about helping companies from around the world access U.S. capital, access U.S. investors, the breadth and depth anywhere from U.S. retail up to institutional in a way that makes sense, given that they're already listed in a home market. So being able to utilize their home market disclosure and not have to be subject to the cost, complexity, and risk of Sarbanes-Oxley and SEC reporting. And even more so as we talk about it as it relates to early stage growth companies. Again, much of that 92% comes from companies that, you know, we would consider venture or early stage growth that don't really need to be listed on major boards, whether in the US or in the UK or in Canada for that matter. And being able to provide markets that are right sized for the needs of those companies, being able to help them access U.S. investors, but still be national champions, whether that be in the U.K. or Canada, is really important to us. And so to partner with Aquis and the CSE and to be able to bring the companies, the knowledge and the investors together here in our New York office is something we're really proud to be able to do. And we really appreciate, quite honestly, the trust of the CSE and Aquis and the companies that have come.
Yeah. Sarah-Louise, maybe tell everyone a little bit about Aquis, the market itself, and the importance of the OTC and getting sort of exposure to the United States.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, we're really excited to be here. As Jason said, it's the first event, but we hope that it will be the first of many. Aquis Stock Exchange is a challenger exchange, and our mission is to make markets better and more efficient. For the modern companies, the modern economy. We have three divisions to our company, Aquis Markets, which is a trading platform for around 6,000 stocks across 16 exchanges in Europe, and that trades around 2 billion a day. And we have a technology division, which creates and licenses cutting-edge technology around the globe to emerging exchanges around the world. And we also have Aquis Stock Exchange, which we're here today to talk about, which is a market or a recognized investment exchange license that we bought just over 4 years ago. So we're a relative baby when it comes to global exchanges. We've got 100 companies on our markets, and we're really excited to be here with our friends, the OTC and CSE. A number of our companies are on the CSE already, and for global companies that are looking to access the US, that US investor base, it's crucial for them in terms of their profile, credibility, and securing additional contracts around the world.
Yeah. Richard, you and I have talked in the past about the importance of the OTC and to the customers of the CSE, and now obviously Europe as well. Companies are just looking for exposure. That's what they really need, right?
No, that's absolutely right. Again, in particular with the challenging funding conditions, and I don't really have to go into the detail there, Steve, but in Canada over the last few years. And as you know, we had record levels of new companies come into the market during the pandemic. And a lot of those companies are looking for secondary capital. And with Canada being very, very challenging to raise capital, we find that we have to work with them to better introduce them to the investment community in the United States, in Europe, in the UK, in Australia, So I've been really burning up the frequent flyer miles over the last couple of years, helping to use that Canadian phrase, plow the road for these companies as they introduce themselves to investment pools in these different jurisdictions. And again, one of the key points of our relationship with the OTC Markets and as we develop a relationship with Aquis is that these investors actually want liquidity in their local currency in the local market during local time zone trading. And so being able to offer that through our relationship with OTC, with a relationship with Aquis and some other things that we're working on around the world means that, as I say, our issuers will be able to make that CSC listing, that Canadian reporting issuer status, actually travel really well.
Yeah. Jason, I'm sure you have companies who say, well, you know, a lot of my operations are in the United States. So what can the Canadian market do for me, or what can I do in Europe? But I guess the world's becoming such a global one that what you're making in the United States could be very effective for someone working in the UK and vice versa. So is that something you talk to companies about the reason for benefiting of this cross trading on these platforms?
Absolutely. I mean, obviously, the U.S. is the largest market, the largest investor market in the world, but it's not the only investment market. And to Richard's point, if you have a good story to tell, if you're in a business that's interesting, you need to be able to tell that story in multiple jurisdictions and give people the ability to trade that story, to buy that story in the way that's most convenient. The traditional way of cross-listing all over the world is expensive and onerous. You can't list on the major boards all over the world if you're an early stage company. The regulatory burden is too high. The cost burden is too high. And I think that's what we've always been passionate about at OTC Markets. And I think is why we connect so well with the CSE and Aquis and others, is that I think all of us are passionate about helping these companies find capital, have their securities trade, have a vibrant and liquid secondary market, but in a way that's right-sized for the type of company that it is. The fact is, if you're a venture company or an early stage company, there's typically added risk that goes with that. And so we shouldn't be running merit-based exchanges. We should be running disclosure-based regimes where companies have to disclose that risk and make that information available, but providing guidance and support and regulation around that and efficient trading. That allows investors to see those stories, to be able to see the pool and depth of the book, and to trade those things in a market that's most convenient to them.
Yeah. Sarah-Louise, when you talked about Aquis earlier and having different platforms, is that sort of the sell for your specific exchange, the fact that whether you're a big company or a small company, there's something for you that will give you that exposure in North America as well? And how important is that for the clients that you're talking to right now, especially after what we've seen over the last couple of years with just market conditions and how poor they've been?
Yeah. Conditions are definitely a challenge still, particularly in the UK. Sort of the regulation has been focused very much on de-risking everything, so that's made it much more difficult for investors to invest and to, you know, to see the opportunities that there are. You know, we're quite unique in terms of our growth market, that we have Access, which is for smaller companies, and we have Apex, which is for larger, more established companies, where we add in additional regulation because they can take it, because they're that much more established, and that signals to the institutional investor as well that those companies are are more established and therefore they're more willing to invest in them. But we have companies on both segments that are also listed on the OTC, and they all have global products. The US is a really important market. As is the Canadian market as well. And so for those, you know, companies with that global outlook, with a product or a launch or an office or contracts in either the US or Canada, it's really vital for them. And they have to kind of show commitment to that region as well. And as Jason was saying, as Richard said, take the time to visit, do presentations, meet people, inform people, keep people regularly updated, and then the exposure grows, and hopefully so does the company and the trading levels.
Absolutely. Just last off, everyone, I want to ask you just a question and get a response from everyone. And maybe we'll start with Richard this time. And Richard, just sort of advice you would give to companies who are looking at potentially starting to cross list and what you think is some things that I'm sure you've talked to companies about and stop the mistakes before they happen, so to speak.
No, absolutely right, Steve. As you know, we've been firm believers in encouraging our companies to qualify their securities in the United States to enhance the cross-border opportunities, trading opportunities between the U.S. OTC and the Canadian Securities Exchange. And what that does, as I mentioned, is give them a platform to engage investors in potential private placement transactions or other prospectus-exempt forms of finance available to investors in the United States. So that can build a substantial pool of liquidity in the U.S., and it also builds a virtuous cycle, as you see arbitrage trading between Canada and the U.S. The U.S. market makers are active in the Canadian book. The Canadian folks active in the stock are active in the U.S. book. So there's a beautiful convergence, which increases and improves the price discovery mechanism. But as I mentioned earlier, it's not just the United States that people are going to. We are seeing more interest. Again, historically, European investors have had an appetite for Canadian precious metal mining in particular. And so we're seeing the miners go back to the UK, to Germany, to Switzerland to raise capital, to advance the projects which are in place. And so, again, that brings us to our colleagues at Aquis, with whom we feel a very, very close kinship. They're doing exactly what we did in the Canadian market, some years back. And again, hopefully we've blazed a trail for them to succeed against a well-entrenched incumbent in the UK market. And we've been very impressed with the service levels that they provided to our issuers that are working with them on listing their stocks locally in the UK market. And collectively, we're working on ways to reduce there's a few potholes in the plumbing that we need to address, that we need to smooth out. But I'm confident that we've got a lot of smart people working on the problem and we'll get there.
Yeah. Sarah-Louise, client relations, I think, is really huge right now, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And what we seem to talk about most, actually, is I think when companies go through the IPO process, they think that that's the end of the journey. And actually, that's just the beginning. And they really need to kind of take that seriously and come up, with a 12-month plan of, regular updates, videos, news, the OTC and CSE support that too. And I know that they engage with their companies really closely. And that's how we three exchanges kind of differentiate ourselves, actually, in that real focus on customer engagement.
Yeah. Jason, final word to you. Obviously, you've heard from the other two and the importance of that client relations. And I know the OTC does that quite a bit and almost everyone they talk to.
Yeah. Well, I tell everybody I meet, and I've been saying it for a long time, stocks are sold, they're not bought. You're a public company, your IPO, your listing, as Sarah said, it's not the end, it's the beginning. You need to be out there telling your story. And even more importantly, you need to understand where you are in the ecosystem and the investor that's naturally going to be your investor. So if you're an early stage growth venture company and you're going to waste all of your time looking at the largest U.S. institutions and you don't have the cap table or the liquidity to support that type of investment, you're just chasing your tail. And so the importance of markets like ours in being able to provide public markets to whether it's the self-directed U.S. investor or the burgeoning U.K. and Canadian retail investor, or even for that matter, the growth we're seeing out of family office and retail in Asia. These are the places you need to be and the things you need to be thinking about. And all three of our markets are passionate about supporting those companies and supporting them telling that story. And this event is just kind of a testament to that, I think.
Well, I really appreciate your time. I know it's very busy and there's lots to happen, and just can't thank you enough. Sarah-Louise, nice to meet you. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.
All right, Richard Carleton, good to see you as well.
Absolutely, Steve. Thanks.
And as always, Jason Paltrowitz, good to see you also.
Thank you, Steve. Always a pleasure.
Yeah, good stuff. There's Jason, Richard, and Sarah-Louise from the OTC, the CSE, and Aquis.